Hello and welcome to this fifth tutorial in a series made for 24HourAnswers.com where we learn to be a better programmer. This time we'll be looking at arrays, and particularly arrays of characters, which form what are known as strings in C. In C++, you can achieve the same result without using char arrays, and we'll cover that in the next tutorial. The first concept you'll need to grasp is that of an array of data types. You do not need to use chars, but can use integers, floats, or even custom-made struct data types in arrays. So, what is an array? The simplest way of thinking about the concept is to realize that these are contiguous spaces in memory that have been reserved for use with your data type. As such, they are much like a kind of list. They have a first element, and then a number of elements after that one, and can be as large as you like, given the constraints of your computer's memory. Now you'll probably realise that's why I've been talking about good practice. There may only be 4 bytes difference between an integer and a long integer, but when you put these numbers into an array of 1 million elements, the long integer would take up almost 4 gigabytes of memory more than the integer. There is a lot to talk about with arrays and with pointers, a very similar concept that we'll deal with in a few tutorials. They form the mainstay of the C programming language, and indeed of most programming languages you'll encounter. Because an array is created dynamically, you would be able to instantiate, say, 1,000 integer objects in a single line of code instead of manually declaring 1,000 items. What's more, you might easily manipulate or transform these arrays over a for loop, which you'd be unable to do with a ragtag collection of random variables. Going further, you might utilize a multi-core CPU or graphics card to process the array, which you could do simply with an array. This is the inherent power of arrays and why they're used in such a widespread manner in programming. A simple array is one-dimensional. This means you manage the numbers involved in a simple list. On screen currently is a declaration of a one-dimensional array of integers. Note the square brackets after the variable name. This is how you identify an array. The number within the brackets indicates that this is an array of 10 integers. Underneath this, we initialize the first element in the array to 0. As I said in the last lesson, you must be sure to initialize array values before you use them. Note also that the first element of the array is element 0 and not 1. The array itself, therefore, is said to be 0 indexed. This means that if you attempt to reference, for example, element 11 at position 10 of this array, the program would crash. Of course, it would hardly be efficient if we had to manually set each element by referencing the array index in this way, so underneath I've written a simple for loop that will initialize the entire array to the value of the index. Position 1 will have a value of 1, and so on. As it happens, I can manipulate the array however I please as a for loop. Just think of each element in the array as an element on a grid of variables, in this case a 1 by 10 grid. I've also looped backwards through the array instead of forwards, which you may not have realized you can do from last week's lesson on loops unless you tried to do it yourself. As I said, this is a one-dimensional array. This implies, therefore, that we can have arrays of 2 or more dimensions in size. Indeed, we might construct a matrix of a 2-dimensional array, and underneath we see a declaration of one of these. This array is 10 by 5 units large, meaning it has a total of 50 elements. Underneath this is a double for loop. It contains a loop within a loop. The outer loop on the integer I goes from 0 to 10. Each time this loop iterates, there is a complete pass over the inner loop of the integer j. So the first time we go through I equals 0, and then j equals 0, then 1, 2, etc. When j equals 5, I goes up to 1, and j begins counting again from 0. The effect of this is that with a very short construction, we can iterate through all 50 elements of both dimensions of our array. To get a better idea of how this might work, we have another loop construction below, which will print out the contents of our second array in a pleasing grid arrangement. This is because the new line tag appears outside of our inner loop. Every time the inner loop completes all 5 iterations, we'll get a new line. I'd just like to take a minute to highlight something you can't do with arrays. Essentially, when you declare an array and its size, you can only do so with what's called a compile time constant. This means that although you can declare an array as 10 elements at creation, you can't pass a variable into a function and use that variable to declare an array size. In other languages, you may find this rule doesn't apply, but this will have an impact when it comes to strings. We have already seen static string literals. These are the messages in double quotes we have been passing to our printf function all the time. What we're looking at now is a string comprised of array characters. In this particular case, we have a string with a maximum of 20 characters, and we have assigned these 10 letters to it. So, what's stored in the other 10 letters? Well, at the end of our string is a terminator, which is signified by the special escape character \0. When this special character is placed in a string, the rest of the array is cleared of values. However, one thing you should try to learn more about the way the system is working is to create a character array and only assign a letter to the first element of the string, and then run the same code to print each character. You will notice that the rest of the elements have junk values in them, because the string is not, to use the correct terminology, null terminated. The null terminator escape sequence can also be set by assigning the numeric 0 to a character, but be careful not to set the character to the value of the character 0 instead, as the two are quite different. And here I'm showing the output. First of all, we have our 10 element array, where I've looped through the elements 0 to 9. In each of those is the corresponding value at that entry. So as you can see, the fifth element has the value 5 and so on. After this, we have our matrix, the two-dimensional array of 10 by 5 values. Now if you remember the way that this was calculated, the column position is multiplied by the row position to give the cell value. So all of these outer ones are 0 because they're either multiplied by a row or column at entry 0. At entry 1, we just get the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. If we go diagonally, we get square numbers 1, 4, 9, 16. We could go across to 5 and look at the multiples of 5 or 9 and so on. Lastly, we had our string, which was just the words, some words, split out into its individual letters. Each one is on a new line, just to demonstrate the power of using arrays, and that you can see this large gap after the S before the press any key to continue statement, which indicates those empty positions after the string. That's pretty much it for arrays. Please do mess around with this and try and pick up a better understanding of everything if you're unsure of any elements. But above all, if you have any questions, make sure you post them below and I'll get back to them. Thank you.